Hey, She Army. It is Wisdom Wednesday once again. So excited to be here. So today is a special Wisdom Wednesday because today I woke up and not only was I a best-selling author, but I am an international best-selling author. So that is really amazing news. And want to just send a special shout out to all of my co-authors. There's 25 of us in total and the She Rises Studios team. But Becoming an Unstoppable Woman is officially an Amazon international bestseller. We've hit 6 categories so far. And, you know, I only can imagine what's, this is like day 2. Thanks so much. This is day 2, so I can only imagine what day 3, day 4, like I'm just so elated and just thank you guys for your support, all your kind words. So Becoming an Unstoppable Woman is really a whole movement and my hope is that, you know, everyone shares with someone that needs to hear the message and we keep passing the torch, keep igniting the torch. And helping other women to achieve that unstoppable mindset. Everybody is in a different place in their journey to becoming an unstoppable woman. That's truly my belief. But I think we can all help each other get there. So just really want to echo that again. Can't say it enough. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart. And more exciting things to come. The book tour, I'm really excited for what's coming next. So I'll keep you guys updated. But yeah, definitely. So if you guys have any questions about becoming an unstoppable woman or anything else that I'm working on, you can drop your questions in the chat and I will definitely answer. But tonight we're actually going to be talking about building a team in your business. This is a popular question that I get from a lot of my clients. And hey, Adriana! popular question I get from my clients. And I wanted to kind of cover that topic, especially since I'm like in the midst of a huge collaboration and teamwork really does make the dream work. But it kind of got me thinking about what that looks like in your business as far as when's the right time to build a team, what does that look like, and what are some common mistakes that people make, you know, when it comes to actually building a team. So the first thing that I see a lot is scaling too quickly. And, you know, definitely when you first start out, you know, there's always, of course, let's talk about the reality of having not a significant amount of cash flow, right? Trying to get sales to come in so that you can become profitable so that you can expand. And sometimes we do have to go out on a limb and get a person so that we can get to the next level. But a lot of times what I see is people, they start out with a bunch of people on their team. And honestly, unless you already have established business or established revenue or capital saved, it's going to be very difficult. And honestly, I wouldn't recommend it. As someone who's built things from the ground up, it's important to kind of get that head start or running start in the beginning. And having a huge staff in the beginning is going to be quite difficult to manage in terms of your cash flow, which is important for businesses that are first starting to get to that next level. So that's one thing. The next is, on the flip side of that, making the mistake of thinking you can do everything alone. You know, especially a lot of us are solopreneurs. You know, we wear all the hats in our business, and that's very common, especially in the beginning. However, there does come a point to where there's not enough hours in the day. There's not enough hands. You are going to need some assistance in order to, you know, get to that next level, process more orders, coach more people, create more templates, whatever it is that you're doing. you're going to need that extra pair of hands, and you're going to need a strong team behind you. So, you know, Rome was not built in a day. And honestly, behind every strong woman, there are a team of other women cheering her on. And so I say the importance of a strong team, I can't stress it enough. Because you as a CEO, you will cap out. And honestly, there are going to be things that are not the best use of your time. So if you truly are interested in maintaining that CEO position in your business, it's not to say that the tasks are beneath you. It's just that if you want to take your brand to the next level, you cannot be involved in the minutia every single day. It's not possible. And you will have to delegate that task to someone that you trust so that your business can go further. Your team should really support you so that you can do your best thinking. You should be the visionary and making the decisions to be able to drive the business forward. Doesn't mean that you don't do anything in your business. Doesn't mean that you don't know how to do the task. I'm very much a doer. So like I have to do things in order for it to make sense for me to be able to delegate to someone else. I've always been that way. And so, you know, I don't ask people to do something that I wouldn't do myself. And I don't, and I always know the most intricate pieces of the task also so I can write SOPs or standard operating procedures. We talked about that before. But essentially, you should know all the intricacies and inner workings of your business. It doesn't mean you have to do them, right? You just want to operate in your zone of genius. But you should at least know what it is that if you're delegating something, what that person is doing. You may not be the best at that task, but you know, as a CEO, as a decision maker, you should be knowing at least what the outcome of the result's supposed to be or how it's supposed to look. Very, very important. Especially as you bring on people that you're supposed to be trusting to do that particular task for you. Like social media is a great example. A lot of folks, solopreneurs, they want to manage all the things, all their social media. They want to do all the content. At a certain point in time, once your business gets to a certain level, it's, you know, unless that like that is your zone of genius and that's how you're driving the business forward or your business is related to social media, it's probably not going to be the best use of your time to be there creating the content, shooting the videos, like on Canva, making all the stuff or on a Photoshop. Like it's just not going to be the best use of your time. And your business is going to plateau or stagnate because you are continuously doing those tasks. So something to think about. So how do we kind of combat that or come out on the other side to where we actually are building a strong team and moving forward? So a few things that I, as someone who's actually run quite a bit of teams in my day, also very large teams. So in my full-time position, my team was over 140 people. So my leadership team was over 25 people to give you an idea of the like magnitude of like how much I had to know. And I probably I was the only person who actually knew every single job on my team and how to do it, like down to the entry level, because I came from the entry level position and I worked my way up as a contractor. So like I knew like literally every button that needed to be pressed, whatever they were clicking, what they were saying on the phone, I knew all of it. So when it came to making decisions for the team and the department and how to do things, there was nobody that could tell me that something, it was impossible because I knew exactly what should be done. And so that actually made me a better leader and a better decision maker. And I never put my team in a position as to where I promised something and we couldn't deliver. If I'm going to say we're going to do something, I knew with 100% certainty that we would be able to deliver. And so that's what I feel like is that's the best position to be in as a CEO. But some of the things that I learned in running those complex and large teams, and in my studio, I have a staff of over 20. And people sometimes, they say hire for your weaknesses. I don't think that's necessarily true. Some people may disagree with me. I say hire for your strengths and for your weaknesses. And the reason why I say that is because, yes, you do want folks who are strong in the areas that you are weak to help balance out the team. But you also want to hire for your strengths because again, you are not going to be able to do all the things all the time, right? And so if you're looking for your leaders, right, you all your leaders are going to have different traits, but ultimately in the ship that you're steering, they are probably going to be similar to you. If you follow Stephen Covey, if you follow John Maxwell, I believe it's John Maxwell that talks about the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership, and also Ken Blanchard has situational leadership as well. If you haven't checked out those books, I definitely recommend those for folks leading teams, because it kind of talks about folks like your team member's skill set and how when you hire, you're not going to be able to hire anybody whose skill set is greater than yours. If you do, like by a fluke chance, that person probably is not going to stay on your team very long. So typically what happens is you typically hire, like, let's say your skill set, let's use 1 through 10. That's what they use in the book. Your skill set's at an 8. You're going to hire 8 and below, right? And of course, the goal is always to get to 10 and be able to, you know, continue to advance your skill set and your team member skill set. But in that, you know, that was something I actually had to learn. And I'm like, these people don't do it exactly like I do it. Why not? And no one's going to be you. And that's really important for you to kind of internalize and accept. But the important thing is, are they getting the job done? Like, is it going to be done? And also, is it done within the standards that are acceptable to you and to your brand? And so there's a lot of things that while it's not done the way that I would particularly do it, as long as it's done in a manner that is of the standards that I expect of my brand, I'm okay with it. I don't worry. I don't stress over it. But I do offer constructive feedback, not criticism, constructive feedback to help that person grow in their own role. So like, for example, I'm a stickler for like misspellings and things like that. In any type of public facing communication. So like social media, newsletter, like I don't like that. So I want to, you know, make sure that is like, because I believe that says something, right? If you continuously put out things that, you know, aren't edited. So, you know, that's one of the things I'm like, well, guys, no, we need to make sure that this is, you know, it sounds professional. It looks professional so that it is on brand, right? That's just a part of my brand and who I am. So also I probably have a touch of OCD, not going to lie. But things like that, you know, telling someone how to better, instead of saying, oh, this is wrong, give them some feedback on how to better edit something or better look over it or create a process by which there's multiple sets of eyes, right? So that's what we did in one of my businesses so that more people are looking over it so that we catch those mistakes and it produces a better finished product. So hopefully that example helps, but definitely hire for both your strengths and your weaknesses, because when you're looking for your leaders are probably going to have more of your characteristics and traits, but they probably will. But also you do want people to think differently from you. So like on my leadership team, I have folks who think their work ethic is the same, which is what I need in order to be able to feel balance and drive my brain forward, but like idea wise and like how they might think or solve a problem is different from me, which helps that when we're having our leadership meetings or we're discussing things as a team, there's a different perspective. I'm very aware of group think. And what that means is that everybody just thinks the same way. You are kind of all in a rut and you never actually have ideas or create things that are outside of that bubble that you're in. And so that's very easy to do, especially if you are in a leadership position or a place where you're in charge of people. Very, very easy, because you'll just kind of keep hiring clones of yourself, right? I'm very much about, can this person do the job? Whether or not we have the same views on stuff, or we might do stuff the same way, or that doesn't matter to me. Is it done? Is it done to the standard that I need to be done to? Great. They might give me a whole new view on something that I never even thought. So definitely don't be afraid of people who think differently. They're the ones that are going to really be the movers and the shakers and drive your business forward. I was one of those people who thought differently. So, you know, sometimes I was punished for it. don't punish those people. You know, definitely make sure that you hear them out and try to incorporate all perspectives when possible. Sometimes it's not possible as a leader, but definitely I try to do that. Pay attention to your team dynamics. That is definitely something that you should do when you're considering building your team. So again, that's around the group think, not having all the same skill set, same people that think the exact same way that will solve the problem in the exact same way. Try to have a more of a balanced team. You'd be surprised at how different your efficiency in terms of getting things done and thinking about things really improves. And as the leader, one of the things in building a strong team is knowing your team's strengths and weaknesses is important. So like, you know, project management is my background. And so when we got a new project, and depending on what the specs or the specifications were of that project, I knew exactly who should be leading it and also what team members they might need. And so that's one of my strengths, right? So I was like, well, this project has this deadline. I know who would be perfect to lead it and who they might want to bring in. And so that's actually also a teachable skill. And so that's one of the things that I work with my leadership team on, is being able to help them do the same thing, right? So be able to help them to think about what their team members' strengths and weaknesses are. And when they have a special project, you know, knowing who to delegate it to, but also passing that torch and giving people an opportunity. You never know, by giving someone a chance to shine, they might surprise you, right? So all things to think about when you are building a team and creating a strong team. And then finally, as it relates to building a team within your business, here's something to remember and something that I really want to leave with you guys. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with the geese story, right? So if you think about geese, at least geese here, geese fly south for the winter, right? They fly in the V, right? We see them every year when it's wintertime, they fly south, right? And then they come back, but they fly in the V pattern. And there's a reason for them flying in the V pattern. So the goose that's in the front, like at the point of the V, is the lead. That's the person that's setting the pace, right? Or the goose that's setting the pace. So that's kind of, if you think about your business that way, that's you. That's the person that's setting the pace. And so they're determining like how fast they're flying, the direction, you know, all of that, right? Now, what you may not have known is that the person in the front rotates. So like the goose that's in the front of that V rotates. And if you think about your team that way, that's really what should be happening. So when the goose at the point gets tired, they actually rotate to the back and then like they reform the V and another goose takes the lead. And I'll give a tangible example of that in just a second. But essentially, when you have different projects or there's different things that need to be worked on, sometimes you're not the best person to lead that. And so when you're building a team, think about who should be the lead goose. And not to say that that person is like taking over your company. That's not it. But it's more so like you might have a project or you might have an opportunity where it's best suited if you stay in your zone of genius and that person operates in theirs to really get you further. So, but then also there may be times, because we're all human and we have a team, that we need a break. this actually happened to me. And I thought I took a break from my studio, but for those of you familiar with my story, I was going through a divorce. It was the longest divorce ever. Probably not really, but to me, it was the longest divorce ever, because we went through it during COVID. It started before COVID, but it lasted during the lockdown. I was like, oh my God, I wasn't locked down with my ex, but it was just a long time, put it that way. But essentially, mentally, I was tired. I was very, very tired. And when it first started, I was kind of like in my head a lot and not there, not present. People probably couldn't tell that, from, well, I know they couldn't tell. From the outside, they couldn't tell, but mentally I was not there. And so I think, let me see, this is my studio's 5th anniversary when I had started going through the process, and I had to let my team actually take over and plan the anniversary. Like, I definitely wanted to be a part of the plans, but I actually just had to be like, hey guys, y'all got it. I just approved stuff. Like, I just approved, like, what y'all want to do? Okay. I just approved, like, spending for things, ideas, things. I was like, yep, got it, done. Sounds great. I'm there. Like, I just showed up to stuff because I really could not, mentally, I could not be all in. And so I knew that that would be a detriment to, you know, everybody else was happy. They were celebrating. On the inside, I was not so happy. Although I was happy about the 5th anniversary, there were so many other things that were going on. And so, but I had a trusted team that went ahead, they took over, and we got it done. We celebrated. I was happy with the results, happy with how things progressed. And so at that time, for those couple of months where I was kind of going through some stuff, I wasn't the lead goose in the front. So, and that you can only be able to take those breaks when you have a strong team. And so I really just want folks to think about that as they are thinking about scaling and building a team, making sure you have the right people in place. So anywho, that's all I got for now. If you guys have any questions, I know some folks have been jumping on and off and watching, let me know in the comments if you have any questions. But thank you so much for tuning in. Really appreciate you guys. Thank you so much for checking out Becoming an Unstoppable Woman. We're international best-selling authors. I'm so excited. But yeah, if you want to connect with me personally about building your team, about scaling, you can do so on all social handles, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Crystal Vernet. Connecting via Simply She on Facebook at iSimplyShe, and also on Instagram at i_simply_she. And if you're interested in scheduling a brand strategy session with me to talk more about what it takes to build a team, if you're kind of at that, you think you're at that level, you don't know who to bring on first, we can talk about that and how to develop your SOPs and kind of get things going in the right direction so that you can take your business to the next level. So that's it, guys. Appreciate you all. And remember, you too can conquer if you slay hard every day.